Coming to specific phobias, these are recurring, excessive and unreasonable anxiety symptoms, both physical and psychological, but they are in the presence or in the anticipated presence of specific feared object or situation. And what is very important is that this leads to avoidance. So one can have a specific phobia of animals like dogs, spiders, natural environments like heights or water, blood injection injury where, you know, fear of needles or fear of any medical procedure. They could also be situational, say, for example, in airplanes, in lifts, etc. So you see, when you talk about, say, lifts, there is, it can be a specific phobia because, you know, claustrophobia is a specific phobia. It can also be, say, a part of agoraphobia because the escape is very difficult when you're in a lift. Then we come to social phobias. Now, here there are psychological and physical symptoms of incapacitating anxiety which are restricted to particular social situations. So very common, which I'm sure we've all seen somewhere or the other, is performance anxiety. A lot of people have performance anxiety. And what happens is that there is the avoidance of these social situations to avoid this anxiety coming up. And because of that, it ends up reinforcing the strongly held belief of socially inadequate. And it's quite interesting that these people who have social phobia are actually those who have very perfectionist tendencies and those who are quite self-critical. So the combination is such that, you know, it just feeds the phobia. Now, lastly, I would like to say that there are certain medical conditions which can cause anxiety. You can see these. So basically, the ones that I would like to lay more emphasis on are hyperthyroidism. So it's very important when there are anxiety symptoms that we check the thyroid. And also any history, you know, sometimes it's important to go for an ECG, even in a young person. It's always better, especially with a panic disorder. And, you know, getting a blood sugar test. So these are the things which the doctor would do, but this is precisely the reason why it is very important to approach a doctor, even if you're not approaching the psychiatrist or the psychologist, approach at least your family doctor to rule out any of these. There are also certain drugs that can cause anxiety, and that has to be kept in mind. So we have to see if the adolescent is taking any kind of medication, because these medications can also worsen the anxiety or even cause the anxiety symptoms. Now coming to the management. Now, anxiety disorders are best managed with a combination of medication and psychotherapy. So in general, the best is medication is also given and psychotherapy is also given.
I'm also going to talk a little bit about when anxiety is considered abnormal, although Dr. Swati has illustrated that in detail as well. Very specifically from a psychologist's point of view, how can we use a conceptual framework to categorize anxiety problems and the types of anxiety disorders as they are seen in clinically useful distinctions. What are the components of anxiety? Because this again has a bearing on how we manage them. Specifically, how does anxiety present in adolescents? How it differs or progresses through developmental stages? And what the presentation broadly is like. I'm going to touch upon very quickly on contributing factors or causal factors, and then end my presentation by talking about how clinicians screen or identify anxiety disorders in adolescents, as well as what are the evidence-based treatments. I'm particularly going to focus on psychological interventions because Dr. Swati has already touched upon pharmacological interventions. So, okay. So adolescence, as we all know, but I'm reiterating, is a time of substantial change, growth, and transition. Some people call it a period of great storm and stress, though there may be adolescents who get by this phase with, you know, relatively less pressure. But a lot of that churning may be happening inside, right? So That has a bearing on development of certain problems like anxiety, and therefore anxiety is essentially an internalizing problem. You don't see observable signs very easily, especially in adolescents. But there may be a lot of distress going on underneath the exterior. Fear and anxiety are actually the very common experiences across childhood and adolescence. And Dr. Swati mentioned there's a 5 to 13% prevalence, but some studies have reported as high as 31% prevalence, depending on the population studied, in adolescents of anxiety problems.